Good evening, everyone. I want to welcome you all to another installment of the Venus Concept Educational Webinar Series. My name is Kevin. I am the Digital Marketing Manager at Venus Concept Head Office. Tonight, I will be the host for this webinar. Joining us tonight is Torilyn Guest, our Lead Clinical Trainer in North America, as well as Debbie Tavares, the Director of the Practice Enhancement Program at Venus Concept. Well, tonight we have a lot for you. We want to have a thorough look at the diode laser technology and show you its benefits so that you can prepare your business for the upcoming summer and tap into this very, very lucrative market. We'll be going over some market stats, the technology itself, the devices that are available to you, as well as some marketing strategies you can use to maximize your profit potential. Well, I encourage everyone to put in their questions in the question box. I will be facilitating a Q&A session at the end of this webinar. So with no further ado, Torilyn, I will pass it to you.
Wonderful. Well, thank you for the introduction, Kevin, and thank you to our attendees this evening or afternoon, whichever applies. I'm Torilyn, and I will be presenting the first portion of today's webinar with a detailed look on how diode lasers work for permanent hair reduction, and then I'm going to dig into the Venus Velocity device and what makes it stand out when compared to other lasers on the market. So we'll just get started with the next slide. Perfect. So just a quick market overview to get the ball rolling. So again, when we talk about hair removal, it's one of the top five non-surgical treatments year after year. So from 2014 to 2020, we see it over and over coming in that top five consistently. 180,332 treatments performed. And again, this is again from a variety of stats in 2019 alone. 52% more treatments were done with laser hair removal in 2019 versus 2018. And again, that number continues to rise. And on the next slide, sorry, just a little delay there. So I'll just go to the next one. Well, what's going to pop up on the next slide in just a moment? Again, when we talk about the popularity of these treatments, again, we're all aware that we have gone through some challenging times recently. But again, when you talk about that rebound, and that's such an important term in our industry right now. So we really look at that rebound after COVID. So when we're looking at those stats, of course, we see that drop when, of course, you know, that dreaded April drop last year. But then ever since things have started to reopen, we've got this excellent rebound. So we also are seeing a 20% increase in overall aesthetic treatments, again, in North America specifically. So we have this concrete proof that we're getting this great rebound, and these treatments are becoming more and more in demand year after year. So knowing that, this is a great time to start capitalizing on this, capitalizing on getting that traffic in with a highly desirable treatment like laser hair removal. So let's move into the next part of our webinar this evening. We're going to go over just a clinical technology review of diode lasers in general. So if you can just go to the next slide. My apologies, looks like we just a little delay there. Perfect, all right, and so we're gonna go into some laser physics. So when choosing a laser for permanent hair reduction, it's important to understand really how that laser is gonna work, what's actually happening when you do laser hair removal for permanent hair reduction. So diode lasers work because they can cause effective reduction by way of a process called selective photothermolysis, which refers to the fact that we will use the laser light energy to heat up a target to destroy it while keeping the surrounding tissue intact. The target, when we're talking about hair removal, that the diode laser is gonna be absorbed by is the melanin in the hair shaft. And we're effectively trying to heat the hair shaft to the point where we damage the stem cells located in the hair bulge. If we use the correct settings and wavelength of laser energy, we can target the hair while leaving the surrounding tissue relatively intact. To understand this in more detail, we're gonna go over this in the next few slides, and we're gonna discuss how laser light energy interacts with the tissue. So to start with this, we're going to talk about light in general. The sun emits enormous amounts of electromagnetic radiation. So that's light energy. Don't let the word scare you. As humans, we can only see a fraction of this energy. And this portion, this wavelength that we can see, is referred to as the visible light. The manner in which solar energy travels, so light energy, travels in waves. With science, we can determine the amount of energy that a wave is emitting by measuring its wavelength. And so to do that, we actually measure the distance between two consecutive points on that wave. And that really is how we're monitoring how much energy we have and how it's moving. So when we talk about these wavelengths, we'll just go to the next slide, we're really talking about a whole variety of light energy. And so we have a whole spectrum to utilize for this. So visible light constitutes only one small section on the scale of electromagnetic radiation, which is just a scale that encompasses all of light energy. Again, we've got one at the bottom of this slide here. So we have this range of all these various frequencies of radiation or light energy. The difference between the wavelengths refers to the amount of energy that's carried by them. So each type of electromagnetic radiation travels at a particular wavelength. The longer the wavelength, or the more stretched out it appears, the less energy is carried. Shorter, tight waves carry the most energy. And I know this seems a little strange when you look at it, but think of it if anyone has done a HIIT workout where you're moving those big heavy ropes. It takes just a little bit of effort to move that rope in a long, wide wave. Whereas if you try to move that in a short, tight wave, you've really got to give it quite a bit more energy. So at the shorter end of the electromagnetic spectrum of radiation, we find the invisible rays, such as gamma rays, UVA, and UVB rays. You know, those rays that we kind of say, you know, could potentially be a little dangerous. In the middle, we find the visible spectrum, and that's the light that we can see all around us. At the farther end, the longer end of the spectrum, we have the infrared spectrum, as well as radio waves. So when we talk about a diode laser, it falls within that infrared spectrum. And next slide, please. So laser itself, the word, is an acronym for light amplification by the stimulated emission of radiation. So really simply, this is light that is produced when a specific energy source or medium is combined and aligned to emit through specialized optics or some sort of a light guide. And slide. So we know that a laser is light energy, but what really makes it different from the light energy we see in the visible spectrum or the white light all around us is the fact that laser light energy is, of course, in that infrared spectrum, and it's monochromatic, collimated, and coherent. So really simply, these are the reasons why the energy moves in a concentrated beam, in a laser beam of light energy. Next slide. So going back to that wavelength, why is the wavelength important? And again, if you've looked at anything to do with lasers, you've probably seen a very similar diagram to this one. Again, this is an absorption coefficients chart if you're new to this. And so this really tells us which wavelengths are absorbed by different targets. So specific wavelengths are going to be absorbed by specific targets in the tissue. The wavelength chosen will determine what targets that light is going to be absorbed by. They could be melanin, oxyhemoglobin, or water. When we select the right wavelength, it's going to help us deliver consistent and predictable clinical outcomes. And that wavelength will also determine how deeply that light is going to penetrate into the tissue. Again, just a little bit more on that, the laser light itself is also going to be governed by thermolysis, which I referred to before. When the wavelength matches the target, it's going to help hit that peak that's going to make sure that that's the energy that's going to be absorbed by the target intended. So when we talk about different lasers that have, you know, wavelengths that are in the same general area, there's many types of lasers on the aesthetic market. The wavelength and the safety options available on diode lasers specifically have made them the industry's leading choice, as they're appropriate for all skin types and considered some of the most effective wavelengths. On this chart, we go into some of the other solid state lasers, as well as various diode lasers. And there's also, of course, on the farther end of that spectrum, you have very long wavelengths, such as CO2 when you go into your gas lasers. And this solid state diode or gas refers to the medium that the energy is being combined with to create the laser energy. So let's talk about the diode 800 nanometer wavelength a little more. So why is the 800 nanometer wavelength the gold standard? Selective photothermolysis is a precise microsurgery technique used to target tissue in a specific area. It matches the specific wavelength of light and heats the tissue and destroys the target with laser energy without really affecting damaging the surrounding tissue. 800 nanometers is considered the gold standard wavelength for hair removal because it effectively targets the melanin in the hair bulb without picking up on a lot of those other targets really strongly. At this wavelength, we achieve a really high absorption into melanin while maintaining that really low absorption rate of water and oxyhemoglobin. So in other words, it's just very concentrated and very effective at being picked up by that melanin specifically, making it really efficient at going into that target. Just a little bit more about that wavelength. So why is the 800 nanometer wavelength safe for all skin types, especially when we compare it to some of the other types of lasers in the market? Again, you've got alexandrite lasers in that 755 nanometer wavelength. You find ND-YAG lasers in that 1064. And then you see that diode nestled right in between with kind of the best of both worlds. So it's why is it the optimal wavelength for hair removal? So lower and higher wavelengths, they have their limitations. Lower wavelengths lead to really high energy absorption by the melanin chromophore, which is really only safe and effective for removal of dark hair on light skin. Again, it's just a little bit more of an intense punch into that surface. So really good for those lighter skin patients with really dark hair, but maybe not so much on individuals who have a higher Fitzpatrick skin type. That higher wavelength, while safer for those darker skin types, may not be as effective for hair removal due to lower overall energy absorption. Again, we talked about longer wavelengths penetrating a little deeper. If it's got further to travel, it might be, again, just a little bit more diffuse. With wavelength of 800 nanometers, diode lasers provide the optimal balance between energy absorption by the melanin chromophore and the ability to penetrate deeply into the skin enough to reach the hair shaft. So this, combined with the efficient cooling, which we are going to talk about a little later, is really what makes the 800 nanometer diode the safest and most effective for all skin types. And this also includes your tan skin. So the big question, again, is going to be, you know, why would we choose a diode potentially over other solid state lasers? So again, when we talk about some of the advantages of diode lasers, the ones that mainly stand out, we have a square spot size. Oh, sorry, let's just go to the next slide. We have a square spot size that ensures full coverage of the treatment area. Again, when we talk about this compared to some other solid state lasers that have circular spot sizes, it allows for more human error because circles, of course, are harder to get that precise overlap, where if it's squares, you have an easier time of getting that consistent overlap over your treatment area. Diode lasers are considered a more stable technology as they have less parts, generally speaking. You need a little less cooling with a diode than some of the other solid state lasers because some of them will heat up really quickly, requiring really aggressive cooling systems, and sometimes even they have something that fans the tissue on the surface. These systems can use up a lot of electricity and are just additional components that could potentially have issues. With diodes, you have about 10 times more electrical optical efficiency. So you're using far less electricity with your diode laser than some of your other solid state lasers. There's no flash lamp involved. Again, we're going to talk about IPL devices in just a moment. But with IPL devices, of course, you have continuous replacements of flash lamps. That's not the case with diode lasers. In a diode laser, the energy is being created within the laser cavity itself and then expelled through the optics. It's not a flash lamp, so you don't have the replacement of a flash lamp as an added expense. Overall, diodes have lower maintenance and running costs in general than some of the other solid state lasers, and definitely than long term for IPL. And of course, the ease of use for technicians with higher Hertz options. We're gonna talk about Hertz a little bit later, but in reference to that, it just allows you to do treatments faster in quicker succession than with some older solid state lasers and with some IPLs. On the next slide, we're going into why a diode over an IPL. And so some of the obvious advantages of diode lasers over IPL for hair removal is that the diode uses one single wavelength. And again, I mentioned earlier, it's coherent, it's monochromatic, and again, it's collimated. So you have this very condensed beam of energy, which is going to get right down into your target, versus IPL that's a little bit more diffuse. You know, with IPL, we're using a cutoff filter. And although the cutoff filter will allow a specific wavelength that's going to be well absorbed by melanin, it also allows other wavelengths of energy to pass through. Whereas the laser, it's just that one wavelength. The 800 nanometer wavelength is optimal for hair removal because of its really high absorption by melanin and low absorption by water and oxyhemoglobin. Also, with the 800 nanometer wavelength being in the infrared spectrum, that longer wavelength is going to get that deep penetration versus IPL, which is generally in the visible spectrum, which may not penetrate quite as deeply. So the 800 nanometer wavelength allows for consistent and effective depth to really reach that hair bulge when compared. Also, diode lasers in general are higher power, so you're getting more energy for your joules per centimeter square on your screen. So often you're able to see those results in potentially fewer treatments with a diode versus using an IPL for hair removal. So now that we've looked at some comparisons and some general information about that wavelength, let's talk about how lasers actually work for permanent hair reduction. So what actually happens to the tissue when you're using a diode laser? So to begin with this, we'll just go over a few basic terms. So the first one, of course, is your fluence. That's your energy density. It's how much energy you're actually putting into the tissue. So it's the total energy emitted per area per pulse, and it's measured in joules per centimeter squared. Typical fluences for hair removal with lasers range from 5 to 30 joules per centimeter squared. The next term is pulse duration, and as the name implies, it's the duration of a pulse. It's the time in which the laser is actually emitting energy for a single pulse, and it's usually measured in milliseconds. Longer pulse durations are used for larger targets, or larger chromophores, and darker Fitzpatrick types. The last term, and I referred to it briefly before, was the hertz. It's also the frequency, and this is the pulse repetition rate. It dictates how frequently the pulse is delivered. The number represents how many pulses are delivered per second. So when we're using a laser to consistently treat the area, so we're kind of just pulling it along and it's going beep, beep, beep. As we're doing that, we choose how quickly we'd like to deliver those pulses in repetition by choosing the appropriate hertz setting. And of course, if we choose 1 hertz, that's the equivalent to 1 pulse per second. And of course, with different lasers, you have a variety of options for that. And we'll talk in a little bit about the variety of options that you have with the velocity specifically. We'll just go to the next slide, and again, just staying on with what happens in the tissue. So when tissue is exposed to light, it will absorb some of the wavelengths to a varying degree. When the correct wavelength of light is chosen, the chromophore in the tissue will either absorb it or reflect it, or it could even do a little bit of both. So choosing a wavelength that matches the chromophore and is at its peak absorption is the key to those good clinical outcomes. We know that light is reflected off of the epidermis. Light materials reflect more light and darker ones absorb it. You think about being out on a hot day, if you're wearing a white t-shirt versus a very dark t-shirt, you're gonna feel the energy a little bit differently. So think of it in that way. So if we take darker Fitzpatrick skin types, they will have less reflection off of their skin and their tissue will absorb more of the light energy. And so when we're treating with lasers, we want to make sure that when we're treating darker Fitzpatrick types, we're taking that into consideration when we adjust those parameters. In this next one, I just have a couple points about the hair itself. Again, we talk about the laser a lot, but the whole goal of that is to affect this structure. So the hair is composed of many substructures. We have the hair shaft, the hair root, the bulge, the bulb, and the dermal papilla. Structures associated with the hair are the sebaceous gland, these are kind of those external structures, the hair receptors, the piloerector muscles, the apocrine glands, and the capillaries. For good clinical outcomes in hair removal, we have to target the melanin, which is present in the upper third of the epithelium. We also like to target those stem cells, and that's really, again, heating up that epithelium and getting that heat down into those stem cells. Again, the stem cells themselves contain no melanin, but are responsive to heat damage. The stem cells reside in the hair bulge and are responsible for the formation of new hairs. So if we're successfully able to create enough heat, then they won't be able to create new hairs because they won't exist anymore. So going to the next slide, something to keep in mind is that when you're treating with laser hair removal, we need to have that juicy hair bulge. We need a target. Because if we do all this, take all this time to choose the wavelength and the settings, and we do all these things and we don't have a target, it makes it a little bit more difficult. So you want to be catching the hair in its optimal growth phase. So there's three main stages of hair growth. plus an early stage when the hair is just being formed. The one that we're most concerned with when we talk about lasers for hair removal is the anagen phase. This is the phase when synthesis and construction of hair components takes place. This is the active growth phase in which the hair bulb is intact. During the early anagen phase, the bulb is closest to the surface of the skin, and this is the optimum time to treat. We also have the catagen phase. This is a brief intermediate, kind of a mid phase. It occurs when the anagen phase has kind of ended and we're just kind of phasing out into the telogen or telogen phase. During the catagen phase, the body absorbs the lower third of the follicle. In the telogen or telogen, I have people who like to pronounce it both ways, so I like to throw that out there. This is our resting phase. The hair bulb is no longer present. It's now detached, and this hair is either going to fall out or be pushed out by a new anagen growing hair. This could also be a resting phase where there's just no activity in that hair follicle. By ensuring that we treat during the anagen phase, we're going to cause that proper biological response that induces the synchronization of the hair growth cycle. With each treatment of light energy, more follicles are going to enter that anagen growth phase, providing a larger amount of targets for our subsequent treatments. And this will ultimately improve the probability of our long-term efficacy, which is why it's so important when somebody is undergoing these treatments that they adhere to a proper schedule to catch that hair growth cycle in that anagen phase when it's got that juicy hair ball before us. So how does it work? We've got a lot of information here. So just to break down what actually happens. So we know that melanin is present in the hair shaft and the upper third of the follicular epithelium. So we're going to bring in the laser, and again, with the selective photothermolysis, we're going to choose our wavelength, we're going to choose our settings. We're going to emit that light energy onto that target. So the light is absorbed by the melanin in the hair shaft, and that gets transferred into heat. That's that biological response that initially starts this whole thing. The heat generated in the hair shaft diffuses to the follicular epithelium to cause that damage. That heat extends to the bulge area where the stem cells are generated and to the dermal papilla. So by targeting the stem cells within the bulge, we're able to actually achieve that long-term hair reduction. So it's a very controlled process of really getting that heat into those targets. So now that we've reviewed the benefits of choosing a diode laser for hair removal, as well as how a laser works to permanently reduce hair growth, I'm thrilled to move into the next segment of our webinar to introduce the Venus Velocity as a powerful, safe, and effective diode laser that's extremely easy to operate for great patient and operator experience, and also to achieve those optimal treatment results. So the Venus Velocity is approved, it's FDA and Health Canada approved, and it is approved for hair removal, permanent hair reduction, and treatment of pseudofolliculitis barbae, and that's again chronic ingrown hairs. Permanent hair reduction is defined as the long-term stable reduction of the number of hairs regrowing when measured at 9 and 12 months after the completion of a treatment regime. So some of the key product benefits of the Venus Velocity are, A, it's really quite powerful. We have the gold standard wavelength that we've talked about, 800 nanometers, and a whopping 2,400 watts of peak power capability. We have a high energy density of up to 100 joules per centimeter square. And so Venus Velocity is going to provide that really powerful and effective hair removal treatment. And because it's at that wonderful 800 nanometer wavelength, it's safe for all skin types. Again, we've talked about why that is, and again, there are certain components built into the Venus Velocity, which I'm going to touch on in just a moment, that do truly make it a difference and make it really safe to treat those darker skin tones. We also have two modes of operation, pulse and slide. We also have an advanced real-time cooling technology, and this is going to create a very comfortable experience for the patient. Also, it's versatile and efficient. So talking from a technician standpoint, there's three interchangeable spot sizes that fit onto one applicator. And so the technician can choose the most appropriate spot size for their treatment area. We have the largest spot size at 7 centimeters square and a repetition rate of up to 10 hertz with our spot sizes. You also have that choice between the two modes, and I'm going to talk about those in a moment, so that larger areas can be treated more efficiently, leading to higher patient turnover and greater revenue potential. And again, we're going to go into some of the marketing elements as well, but because of this, we have a Venus concept offers a unique business model, affordable price, long warranty, no disposables, as well as Internet of Things integration to ensure a higher return on your investment. So going into that applicator and those fabulous spot sizes, again, that whopping 7 centimeters square on that large one is definitely one of the largest spot sizes in the industry for diode laser hair removal. So the three spot sizes can be changed safely on the fly during or before treatment in just a matter of seconds by way of a robotic locking and unlocking mechanism. With the medium and small light guides, again, still generously sized, especially when you're looking at some comparables, it's really going to give the technician the ability to treat a variety of body parts really conveniently. The light guides are securely locked onto the applicator via a small robotic arm located on the applicator cradle. So the light guides can be switched in just a matter of seconds. The venous velocity interface will automatically sense a change in light guide and will adjust the parameters for the technician on the fly. As well, the actual applicator itself is designed in such a way that the operator, whether they're right-handed or left-handed, can manipulate it comfortably. And again, we don't have, you know, one of the smaller laser applicators in the industry. And again, because the weight of it is quite light and it's really quite easy to operate, you have minimal risk of repetitive strain injury or operator fatigue. The applicator is controlled by a trigger and is easily handled by the technician. When not in use, the applicator sits securely in its cradle with the optional light guides conveniently located on top of the device. And as I mentioned earlier, we are super proud to talk about our revolutionary real-time cooling. When we talk about lasers and really targeting that hair and creating that heat, we want to make sure that it's comfortable, and we also want to protect that surrounding skin from absorbing some of that heat. So we need consistent contact cooling to do that. So we have sensors built in that actually measure the temperature of the sapphire crystal of the light guide 1,000 times per second, providing reliable and consistent cooling. That temperature feedback is constantly coming and it signals if it needs more or less cooling. So as a technician, you can rely on it to stay at that consistent 5 degrees across the board, even if you've been using it for an extended period. You don't have to wait for the applicator to cool down for an endless amount of time. It's just a couple of seconds. And even at the highest workload, it's going to be consistent for you. That comfort is a big deal because you're going to increase the rate that a patient is going to, of course, return for treatments if they find it comfortable. And it just makes it a more pleasant experience for everybody involved. So I mentioned before the two modes of operation. So we have slide mode, which is going to deliver a high repetition rate of short pulses, achieving high average power while the operator glides the applicator smoothly and continuously over the area. This is going to ensure full treatment coverage with virtually no pain for the patient. So we're going to be doing just multiple passes to generate that heat. Again, making it nice and comfortable. The sensation is more of just a warmth sensation versus, again, we do have our pulse mode. I like to call it kind of old school, in that it's going to deliver that high energy, you know, one pull, one pass. It's going to deliver that energy at a lower repetition rate. It's going to result in high clinical efficacy and potentially fewer treatment sessions. And the technician really decides which mode is appropriate considering the treatment that they're providing, and having that option there is important for them. So I have a video clip here. We'll just start it. And so this is a pulse mode treatment being done with the large light guide. And you can see just how quickly, you can see just how quickly this treatment can be performed. You know, she's going to finish the entire front of this patient's leg in just over a minute. And that 7 centimeters square, that large light guide is really, you know, again, that and the ability to treat with that higher repetition rate. I don't know if the video, if it is a tiny bit choppy on my end, so if it is on yours, even with the slightly choppy video, still extremely quick. That, of course, is the pulse mode. In the slide mode, we'd be moving with just a few more passes to really get that heat over time. Perfect. So just a couple more things about what makes the velocity unique. So moving into the next slide, we have just a quick introduction to the Internet of Things. So the venous velocity is IoT operable. So it is set up with its own Bluetooth. So the Internet of Things is the latest technology to enhance business operations, and it helps to optimize everything from treatment protocols to patient results and satisfaction. It provides information to maximize treatment efficiency with the best ROI, and it also ensures that we keep the device running at its optimal performance. So the Venus Velocity is equipped for this, and there are some very exciting things on the horizon for the Venus Velocity, taking into account the Internet of Things operable system. The Venus Velocity guided user interface is big, bright, and easy to use, and it allows the technician to enter their treatment area, skin type, and hair characteristics of their patient, which will generate an effective and safe treatment setting, making it easy to perform effective treatments. It takes a lot of the guesswork out of it. Something to note, and I alluded to this earlier, when treating darker skin types, when choosing skin type 5 or 6, the pulse duration will automatically calculate to a safe and effective setting for those darker skin types. It will also be delivered in 5 subpulses, and those subpulses allow for a little bit of treatment relaxation time in between. If you're newer to that term, it simply means that there's going to be little pauses in the midst of the pulse that will allow the target and the surrounding tissue to just kind of absorb the energy. It makes it really optimally safe on those darker skin types. So if there's any hesitation about, you know, other devices maybe not catering to all skin types, the diode itself is going to allow you to treat all skin types. And then these very intuitive settings that the system is going to generate for you are really going to give you that peace of mind as an operator that the treatment you're providing is going to be safe and effective. Just a quick overview. So this is our treatment screen. Again, nice, clear, concise. The Venus Velocity treatment screens show useful information with adjustable parameters and speed options for the technician to decide. The system will also display the total number of pulses and the total time in use for detailed record keeping. And so those are just the points that I wanted to go over, some things that make the Velocity really stand out in the industry. So this concludes my clinical portion of the webinar. And so now I'm going to pass you over to Debbie Tavares to conclude and to go over some of the marketing practice enhancement management program. So
thank you, Tori Lynn. That was very informational. All right. So I'll move on to the next slide. All right. All right, great. That was great information, Tori Lynn. Sorry about that. Something funny with my sound here.
Hey, Debbie, it's Kevin here. Do you mind maximize the screen?
Yep. I'm just, for some reason, moving my notes here. One second. Oh, let's try this again. Okay, it should be better. Okay, so sorry about that. So I always like to provide a quote to reflect on. So this is why Venus Concept created a PM program and why it's important for you to utilize our support. So we know the medical aesthetics market is highly competitive. Yes, laser hair removal is known as an easy sell, but the service is also everywhere. So having the right tools and strategies that is separate from your competition will make you the winner. So the winner who takes the same ingredients as everyone else, but produces the best result. Also, now let's take a quick overview of what we'll go through today. So I'll just briefly talk to you about our program, a few internal and external marketing strategies, a sneak peek on some social media strategies, and then some the resources that we have internally to support you with the Venus Velocity, and some Q&A time at the end. So here, our program, our main focus is ultimately to support the success of your Venus Velocity services. So we really want to maximize the utilization of the device and ensure the patient satisfaction. So the way we do that is we've created a 3 series. This is where we typically go through our patient pathway optimization. So Obviously, the beginning is also to make sure that you are onboarded properly. Oops, sorry about that. So that's where we focus on teaching you how to effectively launch a new device internally and externally. We also talk about pricing. We talk about track talk, how to properly discuss about your new device, and we train the staff as well. The second portion is where we're talking about the clinic efficiency. So that's where we talk, we discuss how to increase the potential client conversion, maximize your patient retention, successfully perform the consultations, and excel in the customer service. Last but not least, marketing is where we focus on the digital marketing, social media strategies, internal strategies like patient loyalty programs, and even event guidance with some tools on how to properly launch your product through an event. Okay, so I want to preface a little bit here on having a strong marketing strategy. So it is important that we often neglect the word of mouth and referrals in favor of digital marketing practices. But is that really enough in the fiercely competition industry, especially when we're talking about hair removal? Now, have we become so reliant to one's means of marketing, mainly social media, without having any other source of incoming leads? So what if I told you it's easy to achieve additional revenue and just by setting aside a couple of hours a week to incorporate highly successful strategies by leaning on research that you actually already have at your disposal, which is your current customers and relationship? Your current customers are huge assets to your business. It's more important than ever to maintain a strong relationship with those past and existing clients so they stay loyal to your business. And yet many small businesses spend most of their marketing dollars to finding new customers instead of existing and nurturing the ones they already have. So keep in mind that the probability of selling to an existing customer is about 60-70%, while the probability of selling to a new customer is only 5-20%. So these are important numbers. So I went backwards for some reason. I apologize. Let's go here. Let's change. All right. So here, the first strategy we'll be talking is about internal strategies. So obviously here, having a few different plan of actions become a foolproof way to incorporate a solid, successful strategy. The idea here is to ensure that you don't just have one egg in your basket, that you're using all the tools and the relationships at your disposal to have the basket overflowing with sources that can be consistently fed to your business. So how do we do that? This is not to say that you shouldn't market to new customers, which is obviously a must, of course, but existing customers are 50% more likely to try new product or services and spend 31% more money compared to new customers. So these statistics should be taken into consideration when budgeting how much you're spending on acquiring new customers versus taking care of your existing customer base. So most clinics actually depend solely on the marketing to be the voice of the business, using strategies that focus on SEO, content marketing, email marketing, or social media. These are all great when you're looking to get your brand out there, but in today's consumers era, where word of mouth is still the most popular method of recommendation, a lot of businesses forget about a very useful and very successful thing, the customers advocating for your services. So are you going the extra mile for your clients? It goes without saying that excellent customer service must be your mantra, but it can take your customer experience to the next level too. So let's take a look here at the next slide here. So the customer advocacy. This is where your customer is your spokesperson. It takes place when you have customers that love your brand so much that they're willing to sing your praises to everyone. This is also an excellent way for businesses to leverage their most passionate customers to increase the brand awareness, sales, and your bottom line. So when trying to sell services like hair removal to customers, customer advocacy becomes necessary, especially in today's intensively competitive world where there's a need for distinction. Customer advocates are more than just random ambassadors or loyal customers. They're a lifeblood of your business. Like influencers, customer advocates are your everyday customer who are so much more reliable or relatable. When you have a customer who's thrilled about their services or the treatments they've received, now is the time to start asking them to write a review when they're checking out, or ask her or he if he can record a testimonial. If you don't ask, nothing will get done. If you remember Wayne Gretzky has a very popular saying where he says, we miss 100% of the shots we don't take. So here, obviously this is we're gonna jump in a little bit in cross-selling and upsell. I wanted to preface by saying that some of this information might seem like common knowledge, but the goal here is really to elevate those basic principles, the basics that are guaranteed to work when applied properly and can really increase your profitability with almost no cost associated. The basics I'm referring to are obviously cross-selling and upselling with your Venus Velocity laser device and business in general. In both cases, the objective is to increase the value and the patient satisfaction. By informing your customer about additional products or services they may not already know about. So here the key is, the success is both a technique, is truly understanding what the customer needs to go where they want to be with their skincare goals. Now that we know that upselling and cross-selling are valuable techniques, but did you know that it's a sales skill that mostly embedded in the product knowledge you put forth and communicate to your customers? I'm not sure if anyone has heard of a little company called Amazon, but let's talk about them for a second. So Amazon leverages upselling in a very organic and non-salesy way. Yet stats have proven that as of 2021, Amazon earns half of its revenue directly by using an upsell strategy, as we see it on the slide here. I'm sure all of you have been on the website and have seen some recommendations at the bottom of your screen based on what you're purchasing. So let's take a moment to understand what was just said. Amazon earns half of its profits to a technique called cross-sell, or as I like to call it, the power of suggestion. So we could all learn a little something from Jeff Bezos. The key here is really not to assume that your clients know the value of everything you offer. So what can you do to tangibly get in on some of those profits? Well, the answer is actually simpler than you think, is educate. So educating your clients doesn't have to be a daunting task. It can simply be bulking up your recommendations with real data. If they already love your practice and all your other services, if you're treating a patient for something else and you see they have razor bumps on their legs, doesn't it just make sense to talk about the laser treatment and how that could avoid the problem they're currently having? Well, this isn't just a suggestion. You're actually demonstrating to your client that you have their best interests at heart by showing them how this will alleviate a tangible concern. If you knew a treatment was the key to your confidence, wouldn't you want to bathe in it? Well, let the emphasis be on the education, and the education will push the promotion forth. It's simple, but so impactful to the client too. The client already trusting your ability to help and achieve their better self. So imagine the impact your product sells if you sold, for example, skincare with the same formula. Could really watch your profits soar through the roof. So remember, clients do not like to be sold to. They are looking for solutions. The reality is that add-on sales do not just happen. They require some knowledge, but most importantly, execution. So how powerful would it be to ask every sales going forth had an add-on to it? So how much potential income could be being lost right now by not allocating a few more minutes to discuss new services or new products to enhance a treatment that they are just performing or the staff is just performing? Another fun stat is that it could actually cost 7 times more to acquire a new client than to retain an existing one. So the probability is much higher that an existing client will purchase product because they are already a trust factor, there's already a trust factor that is established between you and them. So imagine how much profit would increase if your employees matched add-ons to every treatment that they're being performed in a given week. So an add-on sale could be as simple as taking advantage of a monthly promotion. It could be travel size products being added. It could be also adding an additional service that is new to a service as they're waiting as a patient. So just you have to take advantage of that time and space that your clients have while they're waiting as well. So promoting new services with, let's say, for example, on your on-hold messaging in your practice, it could be just in the email confirmations that you add a little note at the bottom. It could be a prepackaged bundle that you have available at your front desk. Spaces like reception desks, bathroom doors, treatment rooms could really be utilized to a full potential. Okay, so now let's take a look at another example of education. So talking about the financial benefits. So when we're comparing, for example, venous velocity treatment compared to waxing, people don't realize the long-term savings they could have. So if I just take, for example, a full bikini on a $55 price point and they go every 5 weeks, over 10 years, that person is paying about $5,700 in waxing. If they would do a permanent hair removal treatment with the venous velocity, they would pay, let's say, for example, $200. They would have at a maximum 6 treatments, or they could have a package deal, for example, for $959. So their savings in 1 year could be close to $5,000. And this is just one body area. So imagine their entire body. We're talking about thousands and thousands of dollars that a person could save if they just invest in that initial package. Oops, sorry about that. All right. So combining your new venous velocity with a successful cross-selling and bundling option to promote better pricing instead of providing the usual percentage off is always more attractive. Percentages off work when we know the value of the procedure. So think of taking your most popular treatment where you have loyal clients. Say, for example, you have a client that comes regularly for injectables. Why not cross-promote to make it worth their while? So an example could be you purchase a full leg hair removal treatment and you could receive a free cellulite treatment. So these types of packages already have an element that the client feels the add value to their life. So an added bonus to a smoother cellulite-free body now becomes more obtainable than to them financially, since their budget might have a bit more wiggle room given that. So just thinking a little bit outside of the box, by offering bundles that have recognizable elements, look at pairing them with top-selling treatments to incentivize a customer to try something new, right? So if there's something that's really, really popular, by adding a new element to that bundle will kind of give them that opportunity to try something they wouldn't necessarily do. So also, why not you take, for example, your promotion, you could staple them to every receipt, right? So this is a way that your clients are aware of these exciting new technologies and promotions that you have going on. Also, you could have them display to purchase like really round, like in, for example, a lot of people do that in their front desk. They have little beautifully wrapped kind of gift cards with their promotion. So it's an easy thing to grab on for a gift for somebody as well. Here are just examples of a fresh way to promote, a combination of treatments. Some people like to do this prescription kind of model where, it makes it a little bit more fun and exciting and it draws some attention. So another thing that's really, really fun and exciting is to make it appealing, right? So the appeal factor, that is about making what you already have sound and look much more appealing by repackaging it. So have you had the basic hair removal promo for the last 6 months? What if you took a simple service like hair removal and added an exciting element like a spray tan or exfoliating and rename it the bare and bronze promo or the hot leg combo? So as a promotional incentive, why not have a price point too that is very attractive? So $150, that speaks to the customer and it's accessible for all, right? So once they try and love that technology with that first treatment, it's easier then to sell the package where there's no fear of over of the comfort issue or the downtime. So combining your services that has the added advantage of more than just the hair removal, we are also working on the health and luminosity of the skin simultaneously. So what's not to love, right? Have it showcase where your clients could check out or showcase one at a time on social media to highlight how this will better the patient's life. So bundle the bundle that contains two or more services and product have the advantage of promoting cross-selling to drive the interest towards that new service. So for example, if we take another example with, let's say, basic pedicure, why not combine the pedicure with a hair removal service to remove all the unwanted hair that's on the foot and the toe, right? So it's a great way to incorporate the layer of wow with an area that doesn't have much attention going towards it market-wise. So the famous Bare and Bronze bundle is a great example of making something basic work for you by enhancing the patient's outcome, adding on service to promote, and again, the cross-sell, upsell techniques by using what you already have. Let's see. Okay, so now let's just move forward to an example of external strategies. So obviously the practice enhancement, this is one of the things that we do. We work with you with bringing the latest and newest information on techniques on social media. So there's a 6 social media content category that we like to work with, and we'll just look at one point as a sneak peek today. So the most significant hurdle many people have who operate the corporate social accounts face is overcoming that perception that social accounts exist only to sell products or services. So you might look at successful influencers and even many businesses and wonder why are they so successful on social media? How is that they have thousands of followers interacting with their posts when you are lucky to break in double-digit figures, right? So the reason is really that some people and businesses succeed online is because the quality of their social posts. They know what are the best practices. They don't just post to promote their product. They post to interest and captivate the followers. Successful social media users vary the types of social media they post. So they don't make every post linked to a product or listing their prices or even linking to their posts, to their blog posts. Every post is different, and any sequence of the posts include a wide variety of different post types. And this is something we would go more in depth with you as a member of the Venus Constant family. The most significant hurdle many people who operate corporate social accounts is also the perception that they need to be more, they need to just talk about their products and not necessarily talk about the story behind it. So another element is the personalization and the interaction. And let me just move on to the next slide here. So this is a good example of how you could make your posts fun, engaging, get that curiosity out there from the people that are scrolling through the social media feeds, right? So, you know, having a little bit of comedy inside. This, for example, is obviously the famous razor bumps that are very common among men. So this could be obviously very painful and unattractive for both men and women. So having some posts that people can relate to, they see an image and they can say, oh my God, that's me, or that's what I'm dealing through. And then they can understand that the laser is obviously a very clear solution for this problem. So here, this is just really in closing what I wanted to bring everything together, where I want to stress the importance of ensuring that people are going through the goals, the objectives, the strategy, the tactics. Never underestimate the importance of having that goal, setting it. It will help trigger the new behaviors and help guide you through your focus. The goal is also going to help you align and focus and create that excitement among the staff members, so especially if they're being incentivized. So, for example, why not get everybody involved in setting goals? By getting everybody involved and getting the staff members their own action items, you're making plans more easily digestible for them and having everybody be accountable for their own success. This is just simple yet highly effective a way to motivate your staff to achieve their goals. In the end, remember that you can manage what you don't, you can't manage what you don't measure, and you can't improve upon something that don't, that is, that don't properly can be managed. So take the time to make sure your marketing strategy is solid on all ends. If you are or becoming a Venus Concept customer, we can help plan you plan for this process. So let's move on to the assets that we have available. So on our B2C area for all our accounts, we have social media posts. So these are really ready to go, formatted to the right size for both Instagram and social and Facebook. Some have the before and after pictures in the corner and some don't. So you could play around with some of those rules and regulation as well to post really to your discretion. We have the clinical case book. So that's kind of a flip chart type of booklet where it contains before and afters and information about the device. So this is really nice to have in a waiting room area or during a consultation process to show what are the expected results. Obviously patient brochures, that's you know, the standard. We have a lot of videos. A very popular one is a waiting room video, which is very, very well done, where we see an example of the treatment. We show really how the laser works. It's not very long, so people will look through it. We also have tons of videos on our YouTube channels and on our website that can be utilized for our accounts to put on their websites and product pages. We have some, we call it the multi-purpose cling. So this is something that could be put on a window or on a door, an entrance door. So it's kind of those plastic films that stick on the glass. We have the typical posters, and we have also the clinic roll-ups, which are, I believe, quite high. I think they're 6 feet tall that you could put standing. And I believe that is it for the portion of the business development. Thank you everyone for your time. Kevin, I'll leave it to you if you want to move on with the Q&A portion.
Of course. Thank you so much, Debbie, for that very informative session, and Torilyn, you as well. I know we're sort of at time, but we have a couple of questions from the audiences. So let's just answer as many as we can before we close tonight's webinar. Torilyn, I actually have a couple of clinical questions from the attendees that I think you should be able to help. First question is, can we treat fine or blonde hair with this device?
And that comes down to what I covered about targets. Again, as long as there is melanin in that hair shaft, then the diode laser will pick up on it and will be able to create heat. But there does have to be a target. Lasers are awesome, but they're not smart. It doesn't actually know it's looking for a hair per se. So we have to give it at the very least some target in order for us to stimulate that biological response where we get that heat and we shut things down. So if it's fine hair, but there's some pigment present, we can of course adjust the parameters on the velocity on that guided user interface and choose fine hair, maybe even low density, and the system is going to generate an accurate setting to get a really good result. With blonde hair, it depends on quite how blonde, quote unquote, it is. So if there's some pigment there and it's more of a very light brown or darker blonde or even an auburn, then there's still enough target the laser will be able to pick it up.
Got it. And another question from the attendees, a couple of them asked the same question. Is velocity safe when treating dark skin types? What about tan skin?
Absolutely. And some of the things that are unique about the velocity is, again, when we input those darker skin types. So as soon as we choose skin type 5 and skin type 6 on the velocity, it's going to give us some nice long pulse duration. If you're familiar with pulse durations, the general pulse duration that's going to actually bring up is 170 milliseconds. And that nice long pulse duration is going to pour the energy in nice and slow and controlled during your pulse, which allows that target to really thoroughly absorb all the energy, you know, sparing that surrounding tissue that also has some melanin present. Also, the system is going to generate a slightly more conservative setting when you input darker skin types to account for the fact that that surrounding darker skin might absorb a little more of the energy. As well, with that pulse duration, the system is going to automatically break that pulse duration into 5 subpulses. And I mentioned that earlier, it's really going to ensure that that energy is delivered safely and effectively, even when you choose those darker skin types. So if you're treating someone with tan skin, you can choose skin type 5 or skin type 6 and automatically know that the system is going to generate that nice safe pulse duration, a safe affluence level, and you'll be able to do the treatment with confidence. However, you do have to ensure that they are using proper sun protection during the series. That's absolutely key because any light-based treatment for hair removal will make the skin potentially a little more photosensitized. So especially as we're coming into some of the more beautiful weather on the horizon here, we want to ensure that we're making sure they're using sunscreen and proper sun protection during their series.
Got it. And we know the Velocity has 2 treatment modes. Can you just share your experience in choosing either one of the modes when treating the a patient?
Absolutely. I mean, the main difference between slide mode and pulse mode is going to be that your slide mode is considered more quote unquote pain free. The sensation is more of an overall heat sensation, whereas with pulse mode, depending of course on how substantial your target or how thick and dark your hair is, you might feel a little bit more of that traditional, more snappy type of a feeling. Now again, with our advanced cooling, that's really still quite comfortable for most patients. The big difference between the two, to present just a visual, you're putting heat into your target, of course. With pulse mode, it's like putting a heating blanket on there. So you get all that heat all at once. With slide mode, it's like layering duvets until you get the same amount of heat. With slide mode, we're going to do multiple passes at slightly lower fluence to generate the heat a little more slowly over the treatment. And essentially, you're going to end up creating very similar levels of destruction just in 2 different ways. So the technician can really choose when and where which mode might be more useful for them based on the type of treatment they want to deliver. Also, you know, taking into account the patient and whether or not that pain free might be something they want to choose for them.
Perfect. And on average, how many sessions will a patient need? And what about a patient with skin type 5 to 6? How many sessions would that patient need?
Absolutely. And again, there are a lot of variables there. So it's difficult to quote an exact number of treatments because, again, the amount of target in everybody's hair is very different. In fact, you might have somebody on the same leg, as an example, who has thicker, darker, coarser hair on the bottom part of the leg, which will generally respond faster. And then they might have finer, thinner, maybe even lighter colored hair on the upper part of their leg that might take a little while longer to respond because there's just not as substantial a target. The great thing about the Velocity is you're going to input that information, so you're getting that really effective setting each time. We also want to catch those hair growth cycles. So, you know, on average, we say, you know, anywhere from 3 to 5 treatments. But again, as you go into darker skin types, because we do need to account for the possibility of absorbing into some of the tissue, we need a little bit more conservative settings. So you may be looking at more treatments for an individual with a little bit of a darker skin type. As well, you might have just a few more treatments in a series for somebody that has very, very fine or very thin hair, where, you know, consciously there's a little less target to work with. So it might just be a little slower to react.
Got it. And just referencing back to the pulse mode, how many passes are typically needed for when you are using that mode?
Pulse mode, nice and easy. 1 pass with a nice 10% overlap of that crystal is going to give you a really nice response. The technician could decide to do an extra pass if desired. Again, if there's an area that's particularly stubborn on those lighter skin types, if they feel very confident. But in almost every case, a single pass, good contact, 10% overlap is going to get the job done.
Got it. And another attendee is asking if there will be any unpleasant smell during the treatment, because technically you are using a high energy light to target the hair.
Yep, absolutely. And again, as a normal clinical endpoint, there could be potentially a very small amount of vapor. And that's actually a good indicator that you've created a good amount of heat for a good clinical endpoint. It's not always, though. It's more often associated with a treatment on very thick, very dark, very coarse, densely packed hair, because there's a lot more heat going on in that hair follicle, just going to generate that little tiny bit of vapor smell. Also, you'll notice a lot more if you have your head right over the treatment area.
Got it. And do you think using a type of gel would prevent that from happening? Or is gel just commonly used in this type of treatment anyway?
It is. Again, with the gel itself, it's going to give you, again, you get a little nice little slide with it, but there is a small amount of conductivity into that surface that gel is going to help with. So you get a little bit of good contact with that. It's going to give you a little bit of slide if you are moving the applicator along. And there's a little bit of conductivity that happens with that. So we do want clear ultrasound gel used with the venous velocity. It won't affect the vapor really all that much. But again, it is a minor amount, if any, depending on your target.
Perfect. I think we have time for one last question. The last question would be, can the vellus hair be treated with the velocity?
Absolutely. And that goes back to the fine hair. If anyone's new to that term vellus, we're talking about those thin, fine, sometimes we even call them the baby hairs. Again, taking into account that we need a target. So if you're dealing with baby hairs or more vellus hairs, or even just finer hairs, you know, sometimes on the upper leg, the face, sometimes even on the upper arm, it's really common. There does need to be just enough melanin in that hair shaft in order for the laser to do its job. So as long as there's some pigment present, as long as you can see a different shade between the hair and the skin around it, the laser will be able to pick up on it and you should be able to get a result on it.
Perfect. That's very helpful. Well, we're already 8 minutes past the scheduled time, so I want to thank you, Torilyn and Debbie, for your time today to present this very, very informative session. There's still a lot of questions we didn't get to. We encourage you to email us at the same email address you received this webinar invite, and the recording of this webinar will be sent to you tomorrow at 7 o'clock as well, exactly 24 hours after. So thank you again, Torilyn and Debbie, for your time today. I hope everyone have a wonderful evening.
Thank you. Take care, everyone.